y'all, it's me, Barb Hardly, and this right here is Stop Dragging Your Heels, a show dedicated to giving you all the tips and tricks that you need to stop wasting your time and start doing drag. And since I've only been a drag queen for 283 days, I'm going to get some advice from today's guest, Angela Mansberry. Hi, Angela.
Hi, Barb. How are you?
I'm doing lovely. And now I switch into actually talking like myself, because that's a thing I don't really know how I'm navigating yet, is the character real person divide.
The Southern drawl, so that's not natural?
Oh, I mean, like, I'm from Tennessee, unfortunately. So I can do it naturally. And honestly, when I first started doing drag, I would just start talking in Southern. Like, the instant the wig and the lashes went on, the Blanche just came out of me. So I just kind of ran with it. But
no, and I get that. I feel like, and there are, I feel like some people do have like a drag voice.
Yeah.
And for me, I feel like it comes and goes. Like, I'll start talking in a mid-Atlantic accent for no reason. but that's like my drag voice. But then I just talk normal. I don't know.
But that's very like old Hollywood. Or that's like that's the vibe in a way, you know?
Yes.
But I also like, as I'm discovering that Barb is kind of a glam queen, I did not expect this to happen, but I still like having a big brassy voice, because the disparity or whatever is really funny to me. But
yeah, anyway. Sure, it's like a Southern Marilyn Monroe.
Yeah, hi y'all. But so let's go on and get started. What are your pronouns in drag, and what's your hometown?
So my pronouns in drag are she, her. They, them is fine as well. I grew up in Howell, New Jersey, which is a small town off of Route 9 in central New Jersey, which some people think central Jersey doesn't exist, but it does. So I grew up in a small town pretty much. But it had a really great theater program. My high school was essentially like a magnet school for everyone in the whole district to go and specifically do theater. So we didn't have like gym class. I know.
The dream.
I know. I tell homosexuals about this now. I'm like, oh, I'm sorry. I didn't take gym. I don't know how to do the sports.
My mom did get me out of gym for like 6 years. So I was lucked out because of a hole in my eardrum.
Well, we did dance instead. So we would take like modern dance. But it's really funny too, because my sister is a physical education teacher. So it's very two different paths completely.
You wear the dresses and she teaches the volleyball or like the kickball?
She wears the swooshy pants and gets to go to work in comfy clothing. And I am the opposite of comfortable.
Well, and now I think that I'm going to ask queens about their drag names. And I feel like yours is one of the more obvious ones. I don't know. Like, where did it come from? I mean, I know where it came from, but.
Well, and it's a play on Angela Lansbury, which there are definitely people who don't know that. Some people are just, I get glazed over looks and I'm like, okay, not my audience. That's okay.
Yeah.
But I actually started as a college joke among our friends. For some reason, we found Angela Lansbury very entertaining. And we would say Angela Mansberry. And it was one of those things that when I did drag for the first time, which I'm coming up on 5 years.
Yay.
It was an instantaneous of like, well, that's going to be my name. That's going to be my name. And it was, and it's one of those journeys, because I feel like when you first do drag, you really don't know what you're going to be doing with it later. I truly thought I was just going to get it out of my system and be fine. but no, my drag mother suddenly Seymour. She was like, no, you're going to get addicted to it, girl. They all do. Yeah. And so it became one of those things where like, I first knew her from musical theater. The PBS filmed version of Sweeney Todd was my favorite role in all of musical theater. It still is. I love Mrs. Lovett. And her performance I love because it's so comical despite this dark circumstances.
Yeah.
So I always loved her optimism, her joy, despite the fact that she's a poor baker in London. And it became one of those things that once I started pursuing Angela Mansberry more, I dove deeper into her. I dove deeper into her films, her TV work, exploring more of her musicals. Because true story, I had never watched Murder, She Wrote.
Oh, wow.
After taking the name.
Wow. Well, I'm glad that you caught up.
Oh my God, because the gays would be like, what do you mean you haven't watched Murder, She Wrote?
Well, so like my drag name is a play on Bob Hartley, which is Bob Newhart's character from the Bob Newhart show, which I understand when no one knows what that is. I think Frank DeCaro was the first person who, when I said my name, he was like, oh, Bob Hartley. And I was like, oh, it makes sense that you know who this is.
Well, I just learned that, did not know that.
Exactly. Yeah, which I'm fine. But I, 4 years ago, I was like, I hit on the pun of Barb Hardly, and I was like, oh, that'd be a great drag name. But then almost 4 years to the month, it was like June 2018 that I tweeted that. 4 years later, the Amazon orders start coming in.
You know? That's, you can't wait. There's no way to stop it. It's like that song from The Sound of Music. There's no way to stop it.
No, take it over.
And it's such a fun exploration, because the more I learned about Angela Lansbury, the more I loved her. The more I was like, this is a very professional actress who constantly played older characters than what she actually was, which that kind of what is transitioned into the makeup that I do, which was not initial. That was not an initial plan. That was just something that I explored. And I'm like, I really like being an older woman. They get it, like, it's a lot more fun, and also like life's too short. Why not? Why not just be an older woman?
Yeah. Well, and you also did glam. You just posted a photo of like a really glam look that I was like, honestly, that outfit was amazing.
So it was one of those things, like, because I do my own makeup. I've never painted anyone else's face. I don't know how to do that. I'm not a makeup artist. I just stumble along. And so it was a friend of mine, Lilith Moon, who's also an Astoria queen, fabulous makeup artist. She had approached me a few months ago and was like, I really want to paint your face. I really want to do full glam on your face. I'm like, okay, let's do it for April Fool's Day. That'll be fun. And I thought we'd both forget about it. And then it was like the week before, it was like, oh yeah, we're going to do that. And it was one of those things that I'm such a control freak. I'm a Virgo. I like doing things the way that I do them. But I was very proud of myself. I sat there. I let her do her thing. She did a fantastic job.
Yes.
But it's just so funny looking in the mirror and not recognizing yourself again. Like, yeah. I've gotten used to seeing this monstrous face in the mirror. But like seeing this glammed up face, like people were saying it was really funny because I still do my material. And people are like, you're still doing the Angela faces, even though you have no wrinkles and you have no accentuation of your face. And so it was definitely like an out of body experience feeling that beautiful. But it was really fun. I was like, you know what? Try something new. Have some fun with it. It's really not that serious. Just like,
yes,
have a good time with it. And that's something that I've been constantly reminding myself the more I do this, is you just gotta have fun, people. It's not rocket science. We're not saving babies. It's like, we are there to entertain people and give them a laugh. My favorite thing about what I do is when they come up to people, come up to me at the end of the show and they're like, I had a really bad day today and you made my day. That makes my day. That's my favorite thing about what I do.
That is the important stuff. Yes,
it is. Like, let's just have fun with it. Life's too short.
So before we get into the origin section of the chat, where we'll dive more into your origin, we will ask the first Drag Race question, because we will pepper these throughout, because I know if you're listening to a drag podcast, you want to know if you are Team Coco or Team Melissa. But that's not the question I'm asking. I'm asking, what is the season that you rewatch the most? Not even favorite, maybe not best, but that you rewatch the most.
Here's some tea. I don't think I've ever rewatched a single season of that show.
I'm so glad that you are not addicted then.
Well, because it's like, I feel like it's so much when it's happening. And then within 6 months, we've got another one at this point.
Or there are currently three running right now and a fourth launching there. So shoot me. This is horrible. Yeah.
Keep up anymore. But it is one of those things, like, as a drag queen, you have to watch this. You have to know what's going on and what the conversations are, because every homosexual is going to be like, who do you think is going to win? And I'm like, I don't care. but it is. But I think maybe not the answer to the question, but like my first season that I remember falling in love with it, like if I were to rewatch it, which probably I wouldn't, is season 4 with Sharon Needles. I Sharon Needles was for me very much an eye-opening drag character. I had never seen something like that. And of course, Sharon, it's a whole messy thing now, but
yeah.
But But that for me at the time was really huge. I was seeing a gothic comedy queen was something that really light bulb in my head that I used later in life.
I obviously, yeah. Well, so let's get into the origin. When did you like land on this character? Like, were you always doing like the older makeup, or did that take some time?
I mean, the first time I did makeup, the first time I did the show was at Altross. We should probably mention you did the debutante show, which I also
Yes.
did.
Yes, Angela gave me my drag performance debut, which I am still chasing that high.
Oh, you know, I get it. I get it. And it was one of those. I remember the night before I did that show. I basically had a month to get the entire look, all of it together. And I remember the night before I was practicing the makeup again, and I literally just started crying because I wasn't looking pretty. I had spent like $1,000 on all this stuff just to try. I was going to CVS and just grabbing things and running away because I didn't want to be in the women's section. Now I'm like, please, I don't care. But it was one of those, like, I literally videoed myself being like, calm down. If this happens to you tomorrow, just put some glitter in the middle, put some darker on the sides. No one will care. And
Yeah.
when you look back at that makeup, that's pretty much what it looked like. Was like, okay, we got through this, but it wasn't great. But it was the kind of thing that I started it because I started thinking about, like, because you watch so many makeup tutorials when you're trying to first do drag, and I feel like it's very much you have to take what you like from all those different tutorials because at the end of the
Yeah.
day, no one has the same face. And so you really have to figure out the way that the makeup works on your face. So I tried like a few different celebrity makeup tutorials and then kind of took the things that I liked.
Well, who was your biggest influence then? Like, is there one that you're
I
like,
mean, the biggest one for me, I think, was probably Trixie Mattel,
yeah.
because I just remember watching that thinking, how the hell does that process become what she is? Like all the white, all the black, the makeup is so odd. During the process, you got to trust the process. That's a lot of what doing
Yeah.
makeup. But then it was also like I would watch people do old age makeup. So then I would kind of take that and adapt it to what I wanted to do with it. But in terms of like first journeys in drag, I'm trying to think of more option. It was aside from makeup, I mean it was a journey. And I feel like, well, when I started, I definitely wanted to be a musical theater queen. That was my
Yes.
first thought. My inspiration was Suttonly Seymour, who's my drag mother. And she is the queen of show tunes.
I mean, the name
And
alone.
I just remember going to her show. This must have been like 7 or 8 years ago. And I remember going into a gay bar, Albatross, one of the first times I'd really been there. And everyone is just singing along to a show tune. And I had never seen that happen in a gay bar
Yeah.
before. Most of my exposure to drag queens in college were very much like just beautiful queens who would do like a Lady Gaga song.
Yeah.
I had not seen mixes, I had not seen parodies. Of course, I remember Sherry Vine on YouTube. That was a big thing when I was in
Yeah.
college. Sherry Vine and her parodies, and I really enjoyed those. But I started very much from a musical theater perspective. I remember the first number I ever performed was The Worst Pies in London. And it was definitely a role that I always wanted to do. And it was really fun. I did a lot of ridiculous stuff with it. But it was a really fun first go at it. And then I started thinking like, okay, well, what is my voice in all of this? Because I feel like that's
Yeah.
really important because we are so oversaturated with drag performers, especially in New York City, that it's like, okay, well, what do you do? And then I just started thinking about, okay, well, what do I like? I like show tunes. I like pop music. I love older references, giving it new life in a different way. And I loved horror movies. And in my brain, it was when that all clicked. It was like, okay, you can be all of those things. You do not have to be one or the other. The interesting thing about your drag character, it's kind of an amalgamation of all of the things that make a character. So then I started exploring horror and murder
Yeah.
mystery, that dark sense of humor, which I love. So
Well,
that
and
was something.
when did you realize, like, wait a second, I've named myself after someone who famously has a murder mystery show, like, which lends itself to horror? Like, it actually does all make a lot of sense, even though they might seem kind of disparate.
Yes. And it really was I did not connect that probably until I had watched Murder, She Wrote for the first time. And there were so many light bulbs going off of like, oh my God, she's great. This premise is so great. It's light, it's fun, it's not that serious. It's really just fun. And my first thought when I watched it was, one, how have I not seen this before? Like, really, really, what's wrong with me? And two, my first thought was, this needs to be a show. And
Yeah.
that was my first show that I pitched was and Murder, She Wrote Watch Along, where I would present you with the suspects at the beginning of the show, and then you, as the audience members, would get to vote for who you think the killer was, which was so much fun. I mean, most of these little gays had never seen that show before, so it was a really great exposure to something that I think is so a camp reference that, like, if you've never seen it, you've just never seen it. But that was such a light bulb of like all of those things going together at the same time, and that's when I knew who she was.
Oh, I love that. That honestly reminds my husband and I were watching Columbo for the first time right now because Poker Face like lit me up. Love that show. And
I gotta watch more of Poker
oh my
Face.
God, every single, I mean, honestly, I would, Columbo's a gay icon, and I don't know what I mean by that, but I'm gonna make it true somehow. Maybe I'll just start doing Columbo drag, but so we'll move on to a second Drag Race question.
Yeah.
Who is your favorite, like, most underappreciated queen that you feel like deserves more love
Oh.
that you love?
I mean, at the time, she was pretty unappreciated. Of course, now she's a total star, and that was probably Jinx Monsoon. I think it was Jinx Monsoon was a big eye-opening experience of like, especially on Drag Race, she was very unique in terms of that she was a musical theater queen who was also unafraid to be stupid. And it wasn't so much about the looks, it was very much about the character and the performance, which is something I remember thinking she was such an underdog that season. And people forget. People forget. I mean, meanwhile, I just went to go see her on Broadway like a few weeks ago. You would not believe the thunderous applause in that theater. It
Oh.
was so amazing.
And now she's gonna be on Doctor Who.
I know, I'm dying to know who.
Oh my God,
Did you see
it
the
is
meme
wild.
that Did you see the meme that she's like she's going to be on Doctor Who just to go back and save Judy Garland?
Oh yes, I was like, yeah. I love that.
I
When
want
I
it.
was when
I
I
want her to be going through all of the queer icons in Doctor Who. That would be.
Yes. Oh, when I was watching it for the first time, season five for the first time, and they got to Snatch Game, and she did Little Edie. It was one of these, like, because usually on Snatch Game, the queens will do YouTube stars or pop stars or people that I'm like, I feel
Doesn't
like I don't
work. It
know.
doesn't
It
work.
also doesn't work. But then when she did Little Edie, I was like, oh, I get this. It
Yeah.
felt like finally, honestly, there's a weird when you don't get the gay references, like in a Snatch Game, you start feeling like, oh God, like, am I
What's wrong?
valid, you know? And so it
Yeah.
takes people like Nina West doing Joanne Worley or Ben de la Creme doing Paul Lynde to be like, okay, I'm fine here.
Oh my God, Paul Lynde. Talk about an icon from my
Oh,
childhood who
God,
I was
yes.
just obsessed with and I didn't know why.
There's
That was definitely Paul Lynde.
Well, I think there's Charles Nelson Reilly and Paul Lynde are over my
Yes.
shoulder somewhere back here. that's not like I honestly didn't even consider doing drag for so long because I consider my male presentation drag because I am honoring Charles Nelson Reilly and Paul Lynde with ascots and neckerchiefs and suits and whatnot. And so, like, you know, we're all born naked, the rest is drag or whatever.
I love it. Charles
I
Nelson Reilly
don't.
on the match game. We would watch match game all the time when I was a kid, and
It's
I who is this queen?
the fact that I related to him so fiercely and did not know I was a homosexual for at least 4 more years is wild.
Tell me
But
about it. It all starts to make
it all
sense
starts making
after
sense
a
after
while.
now look at me. So moving on to our second section, the how-to section, because this is your nitty-gritty stuff. And we can start with even this is what I emailed you about a couple weeks ago of just booking shows and finding shows. How do you do that? Especially, I mean, me deciding to start doing drag in New York City is very like you're starting on hard, most difficult level.
Yes, yeah, we're starting out on expert level. But I think there are so many ways you can go about it. There's no one way. And that I think is the hardest thing. There's no like how-to guide on how to do this, especially in New York. But for me, I thought it was a really good opportunity that before I started hosting my own shows, I would go to a lot of shows.
Yeah.
I would go to see a lot of performers and see, just watch how they did it. Cause it really is like, you don't realize it shouldn't look hard. That's the key. Mm-hmm. It shouldn't look hard. And so you as an audience member, you're thinking, wow, this is so easy for her, but it's really not. It just looks easy because they're experts and know I've done this before and know what they're doing. But like the crowd work is such a learned skill.
Yeah.
That you cannot just, I do think there's something about like, I grew up doing theater. And so for me, it was very much about like, I knew how to be on a stage. I knew stage presence. And I know one of those things that is definitely tougher to teach for people who didn't have background in performing. But in terms of crowd work, that is something that you only get by hosting. And how do you get those opportunities? So, I mean, for me, my journey was, I did the debutante show. It was a really great experience. I was like, okay, now what? So then I just started looking at friends who hosted open drag nights, essentially. You could show up and perform a number. And those were very rewarding too, because you meet a lot of people. Because that's a lot of the game too, is not just that you're a great performer, it's who you know and how they know you.
And that they don't hate you, that you're also being nice.
Don't be an asshole. Yeah. It's not worth it. Like it's, and that is, I think, a very important skill that people don't realize is like, you can be the biggest bitch on stage reading people for filth. I don't know if I'm allowed to curse on this, but oh,
please go off.
But you have to be professional. You have to be on time. You have to know what you're doing, and you have to know that the people that you're mocking are in on the joke.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think that's very important, and something that people think they could just be a bitch on wheels and that's going to make them a star. That's stars. You have to be, it takes a lot of money to be that big of a bitch in real life.
Yeah.
But for me, it was like, I did some first timer nights, it was hard. I had a full-time job. So it's always hard to find the time to do it. But it was something that I found was really therapeutic for me to be. I've always needed a creative outlet, no matter what it was. I used to take like playbills apart and decoupage them on canvas and sold them. I did that for a bit.
Crafty. Well, I mean, that comes I'm very into play crafty. Now. Yeah.
I love a craft. But so I was always looking for something creative to do, and drag really was a combination of a lot of things that I really liked.
Oh, yeah.
But it was, so I started doing one-off things. But then I really was just, okay, I want to host my own show now. And it was something that I think it was after like a year of just like gauging my ground, seeing what other people were doing, getting a lay of the land. And then it became, okay, I want to do this show. It's going to be themed around Murder, She Wrote.
Mm-hmm.
I did it at like a time when there was not normally a show. So I was like, give me a shot. Like, you have nothing else going on at this time.
You will sell drinks at this time now.
Yeah.
Like
it's at a random time that you never have performers doing, but I can sell drinks during that time. Yeah. And it was, I was even like, you don't even have to pay me. I will just do it. And then I approached it like Shark Tank. I'm very methodical.
Yeah.
And so I was like, this is the proof of concept. I will give you the proof of concept that this is a good idea. And then you can pay me for it.
Yeah.
Which I think was the right way to go. Cause I don't know if they would have done it if they had to pay me right off the bat.
Well, and now you have like, you have a lot of shows every week, which gets me to like, I think one of the biggest hurdles, one that I am experiencing myself, is getting to shows in drag. Because I've only had to leave my apartment dressed, you know, as gorgeous as this twice. And both times were a lift to the venue with my husband. And especially nowadays, as for some reason, we're sliding back into like the 1970s for some reason.
Yeah.
So anyway, how did you navigate that at the start? Like, was it a fear? How did you like get over that?
I think it's still something I navigate. And I'm very much always checking in with myself to make sure I feel safe. But it is, I mean, 9 times out of 10, I'll take a car. If it's close by, a lot of my shows are in Queens. So at least I'm not spending like $50 on an Uber to get somewhere.
Yeah.
That's the nice thing. I live like 5 blocks away from Albatross, so I can stumble on there and I don't need to buy. I just go there in full drag. And it's so, I mean, it's one of those things where people will either look at you in an interesting way, either like acknowledging that you look like you look, or most people just don't even make eye contact with you, which I prefer, quite honestly.
Yeah,
I don't need to talk to you. I don't need to this. I'm on my way to work. It's not a big deal. But I mean, Uber drivers, fine. I've never had a problem. What I'm more navigating now is being comfortable in the subway, which is something I've only done a few times.
Yeah.
And I think what I've realized is us as New Yorkers, we have seen much crazier shit on the subway on a daily basis.
Yes.
So me in like full face and sweatpants and a hat is not the biggest groundbreaking thing that anyone has seen on their afternoon commute.
No, God, no. And I mean, it is. Yeah, it is. It is interesting because like you're drawing attention to yourself. This is what I felt like when my first ever going out was a show at Stonewall, which was just like a staged reading of a Buffy script, you know, like as drag queens do. And it was interesting, like, because it was people were looking at me and I could tell it felt like they were looking at me trying to figure out if they should know who I was or know, like, why is this happening? And that was an interesting a feeling. It's like, you'll know me eventually.
And I always tell people about this, but I don't think they understand, is like, being in drag, you kind of forget that you look like this, aside from the fact that like I'm cinched and I can't feel my feet. I forget that my face looks like this. So I'm just looking out at the world the same way everyone else does. It just so happens that I look very strange. So the way people look at you is very different. And it's not even so much being in drag. I find very empowering. Like, I feel like I could take on the world whenever I'm in drag. What the most bizarre thing I find is that like you do a show, you get out of drag and all of a sudden no one notices you at all. And that's probably the biggest gut punch.
Yeah.
Is when, which like, yes, I don't want to look like this all the time. Like I want to be able to take this off and feel comfortable, but also then you also kind of think, okay, like this is what life was like before I did drag, where I was just, I felt unnoticed a lot of the time in queer spaces.
Oh,
and
yeah.
And that was something that I found a lot of empowerment in drag. Cause it just, you know, I don't know. It's like, I'm a bigger guy. It's gay scenes can be really toxic. And it was something that I never really felt comfortable with in my 20s. And then doing drag, I've gotten more comfortable with.
Yeah. Well, and speaking to that, like buying clothes, cause I think like Amazon has been a godsend. I mean, well, the number that I'm wearing right now is a New York and Company number that I found at a Christian thrift store in Tennessee for like $2.
It's really pretty.
And it is neoprene. it's wild. And I was like, well, I'm definitely buying this and I'm buying it at a Christian thrift store. Just stop me. You know, it was felt great. I mean, I found a lot of good drag at these Christian thrift stores in Tennessee. So, I mean, it's a whole new avenue of business down there, but
Yeah, I've never heard
but
of
how have you navigated like finding clothes? Also like, fingers crossed, hoping things fit. Like, do you get stuff made? Like,
I am a huge thrifter, and I get that from my mother. We would go to garage sales. We would go to flea markets. I love old things, pre-owned things that have a story that are just kind of interesting. Like a lot of the stuff in my apartment is my mom just finds at thrift stores and is like, this is kitschy. Take it here.
Yes.
So I get that definitely from her. So most of my first drag looks, actually the first look I ever had in drag, I borrowed from the woman who did community theater costumes for us. Because I had spent all this money on all these things to do the show. And I was like, I really can't spend $50 on a gown. Can I borrow something? She's like, oh yeah, go to town. So, but of course it was a barn full of costumes for theater people who are all super tiny.
Yeah. So,
especially the vintage stuff. I always liked really vintage things. I'm not exactly like, you know, wearing like I feel like a lot of drag nowadays is everyone's doing like the same, like little harness things on the boots. And I'm like, I like to feel like the clothes have been worn in. There's a history. And so it was, I started with thrift stores, definitely still use a lot of stuff from thrift stores. I am a huge Poshmark fan. I would buy a lot of like Mother of the Bride dresses from the 70s and 80s and I would wear those. I do love Poshmark. A lot of But now a lot of, I found like some plus size websites that are just gold. There's like X Plus Wear I really like that has a lot of sexy sheer shimmery materials. Ooh. But it's stretchy and so it works really well with larger bodies.
Lovely.
Because that's the key. I mean, right? I mean, like the number of times I tried to buy dresses that then they'd arrive and then they didn't fit. And I was just like, this is terrible. Once you find a dress that fits well and is comfortable, I got it in like four different colors.
I have done that.
Shoes too. Yeah. Shoes are a pain in the butt. I remember my first pair of drag shoes. I literally went to Payless and the 13 size section was like four pairs of shoes. And I was like, I can't do this anymore. I'm thankful I wear a little kitten heel. I love a little kitten heel. but I buy the same color in like four different colors. Because once you find something that you like and it fits, just keep with it. It's
fine. I'm also like that with boy clothes too. I've been buying the exact same pair of blue jeans for like 10 years. Because I finally found like, these fit me. This is what I'm sticking with.
100%. Especially because it's like, I mean, back in my day, you'd have to go to the store to buy these things. But now who shops anymore? Who goes to like actual retail stores anymore? So it's, you buy it all online and you just hope to God it fits.
I don't know if it's like a tip and a trick, but I have like, you know, the measuring tape, and I just like, I got into full padding and then just measured what my bust is, what my waist is, and what my hips are in corset and in pads. And so like, and I've just gone by that 42, 32, 42, if anyone wants to buy me anything.
Work.
and it hasn't really steered me wrong. So I've been, you know, good, lucky so far. Where you get these stretch fabrics and you're fine.
A friend of mine who worked in the fashion industry got me in full padding and corsets and sized me out. And so I use those sizes for everything. Also, stretch is key. Stretch is so key. I cannot wear a dress that does not have stretch. It is not going to get on my body. I have, my dimensions are bonkers. Like, it is like, I showed this to a friend of mine. They're like, there's no way that those are your actual dimensions. Because it's like, I'm like a 60-inch hip, 44-inch waist, and like a 55 size chest. It's like, these dresses are not made like
that. Yeah.
No one has these dimensions. So it's stretch is key.
Yeah. Well, have you ventured into the like having things made for you territory?
Yes.
When do you elevate up to that level? Because that seems like leveling up.
Well, and then it's like that. Where do you go from there? I mean, once you've had something made for you, it really is like, I want to do this all the time. But I have one garment that I've had made for me, and it was a silk caftan that has a belt. And it was something that I wasn't able to find anywhere online. I love caftans. Oh my God, get a caftan. Oh, yeah. It is.
Yes.
The best.
Palm Springs. Like, I love it. Yeah.
And also, like, when you're doing drag as often as I am, like, having an outfit that is just comfortable is so key for you to be able to get through the rest of the week. Yeah. It is like this fabulous caftan that I have that actually I want it made in like four different colors. That's what I wanted at this point. But yeah, it's something that I've always explored. But then it's always just like, what's different? What can I have made that I can't buy? That's essentially the way I approach it is like, is it something that you can buy or is it so unique that it has to be made? And I've gotten really into stoning. That goes a long way. Taking something from a store that fits well, adding a few stones to it. Oh my God, you will not believe.
Do you glue or do you iron?
Oh, I glue. I don't know.
Okay, because I tried the iron on. And that did not work well.
Is that just like a whole sheet of them? Like a whole sheet of stones?
Well, like you still have to put them all on. But they have like a little heat activated adhesive on the back. And then you can just like iron over it. And it's supposed to, they're supposed to stick. It kind of worked, but I still have rhinestones stuck to the iron, which I will forget. And then I'll go to iron a shirt and be like, oh, damn it. Now there's rhinestones on my button down.
Rhinestones are the herpes of drag.
They're everywhere still. So
I've gotten to the point where I just know that there are stones stuck to my feet at any given time.
Well, I mean, it's also like, it makes me feel like a woman, like a drag queen, because I'm like, drag queen lives here. There are rhinestones literally everywhere.
It would feel wrong if It would feel wrong if there weren't stones scattered about your floor. But it's like, that's a great way to elevate things. Like, as because I know it's so hard when you're first starting with like not having the money to do things, not having access to people who can make things for you. It's, you can go a long way with some E6000, some stones, and an Amazon purchase dress. It really can go.
Yes. Well, now before we get into our final major section, one more Drag Race question. Is there a line or a quote that you say too often that has weaseled its way into your vernacular and you can't let it go? Like for me and my husband, it is when Pearl is in Big Ange in Snatch Game, just mansions. We do that all the time. Or hello, RuPaul. Very, very, we do that all the time.
Oh, Big Ange. You know, I met her once.
Oh, wow.
Oh, what an icon. I love, and what am I? The first thing that comes to mind is good God, get a grip, girl, which is a great line.
Applicable.
Applicable all the time. I feel like that's the first, I don't know if I say that a lot, but that is probably my favorite line. That was Latrice, wasn't it?
Yes. That's like, yeah, that is season four, your season.
That was a great season.
It was.
It's the, I met Latrice Royale once too. She was a gem.
Yes. I mean, that is, so like as for my job, I've interviewed probably 150 Rue girls. I am proud to say everyone has been nice. Which is surprising, I guess, because it's just that many. You would figure maybe like three or so stinkers, but even the ones that have been, you know, curt on one occasion have been lovely the next occasion, which is something we have to remember. You never know when you're catching someone.
That is true too, and we're also all human.
We're all human, I mean, and also we're all in drag. Which now that I do drag, I'm like, oh, no wonder they were cranky. It was 9 a.m. and they hadn't had breakfast, and they were cinched. Like, Jesus,
haven't eaten in 12 hours. But it's always I think for me, it's because like I grew up performing. I was exploring it a lot at a very young age. And so, but my parents were always like, you have to stay humble.
Yes.
And that I think that's something that is so important, especially in this day and age of social media and everything, where everyone is so touting their perfect lives all the time.
Yeah.
I think it's really important to stay grounded and realistic. And that's something that I've brought to my shows a lot more recently, is just like casual, like, stupid shit that happened that day. It's like, we're all human beings and we all just like are navigating through this world. We just happen to look like this.
Well, that brings us to philosophy, because I mean, that sounds, you know, there are a lot of drag performers that might want everything very meticulously planned out because they're in a character. I mean, is there anything that you say no to in drag? Like, do you ever get impulses where you're like, that's not Angela Mansberry? I cannot wear X or lip sync Y or Z.
A lot of times what makes it feel right is when it's a combination of old and new.
Yeah.
Anything that is just new feels wrong. It feels like this isn't the character. Like I can't, like in my world, I wouldn't just lip sync to a Dua Lipa song.
Yes,
I would do my own twist on that song.
Yes.
So it's something that is always, and it's something that I find with like lipstick shades or wig colors. It's like, this is too young. This doesn't work. Of course, then people will say, no, who cares? Do whatever you want. But for me, it's the character is a woman of a certain age.
Yes.
Of course, I am a 32-year-old geriatric millennial, so there's that too. I remember at first I was like, well, I need to have this backstory about like she got married during the war and like all of these. I used to have this backstory that she's been alive for like 300 years.
Ooh.
Which is still fun in the back of my brain. But for me, it's also like I find that when you're that heightened with it, you lose touch of the humanity, which is so important in a bar setting, that you feel like a person and not just a character.
Yeah, well, and also it adds a little, because I come from an improv background, and so I try to approach every bar, but every time I get makeup, and I mean, I don't do anything, I do Instagram live sometimes, like this is not high stakes, but when I'm, you know, in character, I try to just go with whatever comes to me. And it's almost like a reset button every time. Like, mm-hmm. I have the inclination to do what you did and come up with a backstory that I need to stick with, et cetera. And I have to keep reminding myself, this is fun. It's not supposed to be. You're not supposed to have a meticulous timeline of Barb Hardly's entire life. If something contradicts, do improv. Like, it's fine. Just roll
yeah,
it.
It's yeah. all good. I think it's the, because then I would be like, well, I'd be talking about, well, I grew up during the Great Depression or stuff like that. And I'd be like, but I didn't grow up in the Great Depression. No, so I don't know what that really means. I don't know what that would really like. So then it feels like I'm lying as opposed to just living authentically, which is, I've kind of just reasoned the fact that she is both things. She is a woman of a certain age who may or may not have killed her two ex-husbands. And she's also a 32-year-old man from New Jersey. Yes. And she can be both.
Well, and it was even like when I created Barb, I was like, well, she's a sitcom girl. And then I did gown looks for my Christmas special, because of course, in your first year as a drag queen, you need to make a Christmas special.
Of course.
And I was like, I love feeling beautiful. Like, it was this feels great. And so I bought more. And then it's when I realized Ava Gabor. It's like, it's right there. Like, it is, I'm Mary Tyler Moore and Ava Gabor. It's all old sitcoms, but there's a range within that I can play within. So it's not like, I don't have to deny myself anything. I can still,
You know.
And you mentioned Dua Lipa, and I did a Golden Girls theme song matched up with Levitating.
Right. I think so. And it's because also I think the voice, I very much found the voice of my drag character through creating my own mixes.
Yeah, okay. Yeah.
Was like, what makes me laugh? What are the references that I like? And how do you mash that up in a way that I've never seen before? So that's how I found a lot of my voice, was just like, I would make a horror movie mix that is like something I love. I love horror movies and I love slashers. But then it's like, then you got to put a joke in there. Because for me, horror movies and laughter go hand in hand, even though they're opposite things. So it became this kind of like, okay, my own little twist on it is that it's campy horror, which is the way I like to approach it. Like, I'm not trying to scare you.
Yeah.
I'm trying to make you laugh through the lens of a horror movie, which for me and my weird coping mechanisms, I guess, makes sense.
Well, now we'll move on to the final section. This is a lightning round, where I'm just going to calling it a couple of quickies. I don't know.
Cute.
We'll see if that
I do love a quickie.
Yeah. So this, I'm just going to ask you your favorite XYZ and just let me know. So starting with your favorite black eyeliner.
Ooh, I think I use Revlon. I think it's nice. Revlon. I think so.
Your favorite corset.
Orchard corsets in New York City. Oh. Very nice corsets.
Is that like locally to New York City? That's not like an Amazon purchase. That's a
I've always bought them online, but it is it is a store in Manhattan. When I first did drag for the first time, it was really helpful because there were some people in the debutante show who had done it before. And there were some people who were like, well, if you're looking for a corset, go to this site, do your measurements, and then they'll tell you what corset to buy, which was very helpful when I first started. And basically now those are the only corsets I buy. I just buy multiples of them because then when they break, I don't have a corset. So now I have like three in rotation at any given time.
What is your favorite heel, like brand? Ooh. I guess, or what's been trusty?
I mean, they're all from Amazon. I don't even know what brand it is.
Is it? I'm trying to remember which ones. Like,
they're these little
True kids. Dreams or something, like Dream something.
I don't know. They're like $40 on Amazon, and I have it of like four different colors.
Gotta have it.
Actually, my favorite pair of shoes, which actually I might wear tonight because I haven't worn them in a bit. They have like this black and white stripe on the back, and it's reds. Black, white, and red are like my three favorite color combinations. Mm-hmm.
You should do more White Stripes songs.
Oh, sure. That would be fun.
And your fave perfume, have you dabbled in the perfumes?
So I wear, it's called Suede Pony, I want to say. It's technically a non-gendered cologne. So I use it in or and out of drag.
Nice.
But everyone kind of tells me when they wear it, when I wear it, that I smell like their grandmother, which great.
Yes. That's that. What we're not.
I would love to have like a vintage bottle of like white diamonds or something.
Oh,
just
yeah.
To really lean into that. But you know, I do like the cologne though. It's very nice.
And your fave lashes.
301s. I mean, I just buy 301s from Amazon.
It's everyone's loving it. I'm currently wearing like I think four pairs of like wispies or whatever.
Okay.
But I just keep adding to it. Every time I take them off, I'll then add more. So they're getting actually pretty thick now. Also, I should probably throw them away because I don't know how many times I
lashes
should.
Lashes are such a fickle business. It's like, yeah. Well, it's funny because when Lilith Moon did my makeup the other day, she gave me stacked lashes that she had made. And it's real. I was so tempted today. And I was like, no, no, no. You are saving that for special occasions. This is not going to become a normal thing. I mean, maybe I would love to stack some lashes because it really does make a difference. But yeah, it's like, I don't know though, but they're so expensive. How are you going to spend four? And I wear bottom lashes too. So I go through double the amount of lashes.
See, I haven't figured out how to do that yet. That is a, that'll be a journey.
Those are the wispies. These are like the shy that I use for the bottoms. And then I use a 301 on the top.
Well, and also as I've discovered, your targets and places keep all these things under lock and key. Like finding.
Oh, it's such a pain.
Really annoying.
It's really annoying. The other day I literally just had a man follow me. I'm like, I'm not calling you every time. Just I know where I'm going. Follow me. We're going to the deodorant aisle. Come with me.
Yeah.
It's so that he's gonna have to lock it anyway.
Is that happening all over the country? Is that just a New York thing?
I feel like everything... it must just be a New York thing. I feel
so
like they annoying. We just can't be trusted.
No, we can't. Well, thank you so much. Now it is all over butt plugs, which is a pun on butt plugs that I have come up with. I don't know.
Certainly don't have one of those, Bob.
No, I did write a sketch about butt plugs for my UCB comedy group a long time ago. I was destined for this. I don't know.
You could do a whole Jamie Lee Curtis Everything Everywhere All at Once.
Yes. Now that's a number.
That's a number. See,
Oscar
combining
winning.
The things.
What Instagram, TikTok, Venmo, shows, plug away.
Sure. So I am on Instagram at Angela Mansberry. That's Angela, A-N-G-E-L-A, Mansberry, M-A-N-S-B-E-R-R-Y, for all you phonetic folks out there. Then my Venmo is also Angela Mansberry, spelled the same way. Coming up. I'm doing an Easter show on Sunday for Bingo, which is going to be super fun. We decided that we're going to do like a little Easter egg hunt before the show, which is going to be so much fun. I love getting drunk adults to do stupid things. It's so much fun.
One time I got the little plastic Easter eggs, and then I put Jello shots in those Easter eggs.
Work!
And then so when people found one, they had to do the Jello shot.
Yeah, we're doing that for Sunday. We decided that today.
Oh.
I also got cast in an off-Broadway show, so I'm doing an off-Broadway show. The first one, we've got two dates for now. It's April 22nd and May 6th. If you go to my Instagram, there is a link tree, because I am on a link tree now. but there is no OnlyFans there. Don't get too excited. But there is a discount code. If you're interested, there I have a discount code linked to my Instagram that you get $30 off your ticket. So if you'd want to buy a ticket, you can go to my Instagram at Angela Mansberry and get tickets from there.
And people can see you in New York City like every night of the week.
Pretty much.
if you're in Astoria, you're living.
Yeah, I feel like if you live in Astoria and we've never met, I don't know what you're doing with your life. Because I'm always out and about in Astoria. But, you know, I have Sundays, I'm at Albatross. For Bingo, She Wrote, so much fun. I love the staff there at Albatross. It's my second home. So I'm there on Sundays tonight. We're recording this on a Wednesday. So I'm heading to karaoke after this at Queen on 30th Avenue. I'm there every Wednesday for karaoke. And then on Thursdays, I host a bingo at Alewife Brewing in Sunnyside, which is super fun. And actually next Thursday, the 13th, I'm doing Law and Oral, which if you haven't come to that show, it's really fun.
Ooh.
You play as teams and you're presented with real court cases and you need to decide how you think the court ruled. very fun.
Yeah.
And, And then we watch a horror movie after that. So we're doing that on the 13th. We're going to play the game. And then at 11 o'clock, we're going to watch one of my favorite horror movies, which is Killer Clowns from Outer Space.
Oh,
also
yes.
Known as My Life. So yeah, that's all the exciting stuff coming up for now. It's like busy April. And then I'm thinking what's going to be happening in May and June, but you never quite know.
No, don't plan that far ahead. Just got to live in the moment.
Oh,
who knows?
That I will try. I try every time, but you know, I'm always thinking about it. Ooh.
Well, thank you so much, Angela Mansberry, for hopping on and teaching me a thing or two. Please like and subscribe to Barb Hardly on YouTube, and please give me a follow on Instagram at Barb Hardly. I truly hope that Angela and me have helped persuade you to stop dragging your heels. And as I always say, am I a woman? Hardly.